Okay, and so, and which poem would you guys, well, you said one of my older ones, okay, the older one in here.
That you have the book also.
Super Pig is an old one in here.
Whatever you want.
But these poems that I chose here were just about the police. Our aim here is mainly about police incidences and things like that, right? That's our focus. Otherwise, you know, we'll go all over El Barrio, you know. But yeah, I like that. No, I like, see, one thing about my poems, because there are a lot of poets that write stuff and then they don't want to defend it or they want to excuse it, you know. And no, I defend my poetry, you know, to you know, and theirs to death, you know what I'm saying? It's like, nah.
I think maybe the Attica poem, it's such an important...
The Attica poem?
It's such an important moment politically, right? Yeah, but that,
okay.
That
but I always like to read a cop haiku first.
Okay.
Cool. Yeah, I like a cop haiku. Okay, now let me tell you a story about a cop haiku, because that's funny. And the story is longer than the poem, of course. But I'll tell you real quickly. Okay. I was at the Million Youth March. Now, the Million Youth March was about 10 years ago, something like that, right? Over here in Harlem, it mimicked the Million Man March in Washington, and it was about bringing black youth together. So I go there as a poet observer to check it out. And the cops are having a field day with us. They blocked off, they've cordoned off so many damn blocks to get to the demonstration. And then they keep telling you that to get into the demonstration area, you have to walk two blocks that way and one block this way, and then they snicker into their sleeves while they're telling you this, because they know that when you do all of that, they're going to tell you the same thing over there backwards. And that's what they were doing all damn day. And they were really pissing off the demonstrators. You know, everybody was, it was really getting hot, you know? And so I'm watching... It was really getting ornery, you know. So in all the midst of all of this, I look, and there's a piragüero, right? A guy making, you know what coquitos are? Okay, coquito means coconut, right? Or cocoa. But coconut, you know. So coquito are these ices that they make, and they put them in a little cup. They taste really good. A lot of sugar. Tastes great. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so I see this poem, and again, the irony, right? See, there it goes. The minute I saw it, it's the poem. A group of cops buying coquitos. Different flavors, different cops. You can see that. You can see the image of them. They just looked like little kids in the midst of all of this. And each one of them wanted an icy, and they were so excited about it. That's so funny. So I go to a big old demonstration and I come out with a haiku. And a t-shirt. Okay, and then the one in the back I like to. Then I'll read you something serious. The one in the back. Simply arithmetic. And this happened. This happened right here on 3rd Avenue. There are a lot of 99 cent stores. We call them 99 cent store. Because, not because everything costs 99, it's because everything ends in 99. Okay, so it could be 99 cents, $1.99, $2.99, $3.99, everything ends in 99. You didn't get anything there. So simply arithmetic, I'm walking down the street, and I'm stopped because this happens. Today, on 3rd Avenue, between 104th and 105th streets, I counted 22 cops rushing to a 99 cent store in order to subdue one irate customer. Yo, and that's the truth. Okay, now, okay, serious problem. A San Diego, okay, the brothers are dead, let's do that.
Okay.
Page 2, yeah, I even put page numbers on this, I forgot that. A San Diego Southern African night I'd like to talk about. I don't know if we have time, we'll read it. Because I'll tell you what happens with that. But here's the brothers are dead. Now I wrote this right after Attica happened. Now, to recount, Attica was a prison, did they know?
Probably not.
Attica was a prison, a state prison in upstate New York, in Attica, New York.
Still is.
Still is. Okay. I never read poetry there. I did read poetry in Sing Sing. I didn't read poetry at Attica. And what happened in Attica was that the prisoners were, the inmates were demanding more humane treatment. And it was really gross what they were going through. I mean, like now, you know, one of the grossest things that people fight about, and it's probably still gross, don't go to prison, go to college. But, you know, because a lot of writers go to prison to become writers. I don't know, just go to college. You have the same solace in a dorm. Without the bars, and the pedophilia and everything, without all of that, what was I gonna tell you? Come on, help
Attica.
Oh yeah. So the conditions were horrendous, really, really horrendous. Or like slave, or whatever the hell. Anyway, the prisoners took over the prison. They didn't take over the whole damn prison. They took over like a block and blah blah. So the governor Rockefeller called the whole world out to go get them. And so there was a standoff for weeks and weeks. Weeks and weeks.
I think a week. It wasn't a week.
And then finally, what happened is they decided to take the prison back. And they charged and they claimed that the prisoners had shot the prison guards. Or had stabbed them or something like that. No, had stabbed them because they only had knives. The prisoners only had knives, right? So they claimed, and even the newspapers reported that the prisoners had cut the throats of the guards. Well, they hadn't. The guards had bullet holes in them. So even the guards were killed by the other guards trying to get the prison, but they blamed it on the prisoners. And then there was all these reforms and everything, but a lot of people died.
I mean, important point about Attica, it wasn't just about the conditions of the prison itself, but also the resources available. And Puerto Rican prisoners were at the vanguard, right, of this protest, asking for things like access to services in Spanish, right, which they weren't afforded, right, including the right to legal counsel, right, that could speak Spanish, right. So bilingual services in prisons.
Papoleto, they took over the entire courtyard.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but they didn't take over the entire prison. That's what I'm saying.
They had trenches, they had tents, man.
Yeah. You can Google it. That's the good thing. You know, the good thing about the internet now is that you can go find information out about, even if you were alive then, you might not even know what happened. You know what I'm saying? But now you can go and research it and find it out.
One of their main demands was to have education.
Yes.
And access to books.
And Kunstler was their attorney?
William Kunstler was one of the attorneys. And actually, they were demanding to speak to Governor Rockefeller and have him come to the prison.
It was
a
very intelligent
takeover. He refused to come.
Yeah, right. And what I'm saying, it was a very intelligent takeover in that the prisoners, who were characterized as, scum, basically, actually performed in a parliamentary goddamn manner
Like Occupy. I mean, they made a whole, for the time they were there.
They had a central committee.
Yeah.
The prisoners won the PR battle.
Yes.
And really turned against public opinion, against the police and the government.
And that anniversary was just celebrated not too long ago.
Because people would scream, Attica, cheering on.
So much stuff was happening that you had to get involved, If you were damn apathetic if you didn't get involved. It's like, what's wrong with you, Let your hair grow. Burn your bra. The brothers are dead. Okay, so this is written after everything happened. Now, what I want you to see, if you can see in here, is my inspiration for the poem. Yes, that happened, but there's a particular inspiration. The brothers are dead. Their voices will never again disturb those who step on you. Their voices will never again threaten those who are above you, on you, who look down at you. Who you look up to, they spit in your eye, do not hear your cry. The brothers are dead, and the American flag still waves at full staff. The brothers are dead. They are nameless to me, to you, those who knew them, loved them. I love their valor, their bravery, their love for you, for me. They died for you and me. I hope you know that. I hope you realize the importance of that, because they are dead, gone forever. Only in our minds and hearts do they remain safe. And only if we want them to. They will never hear our songs, our chants, our prayers. The brothers are dead, and America says it's still the home of the free. The brothers are dead, and the garbage cans still sit in front of my building, and the stink still sickens me, and the junkies still nod on the stoops, and the super still doesn't give hot water and steam, and we still blame it on him, and the rent still rise. And the wage freeze still continues, and rats and roaches still share my meals, and the children still play in the streets, and the pigs are still in our communities, the brothers are dead, and Rockefeller is still the governor of New York. The brothers are dead. They died for you, for me, and for the many more sisters and brothers who are dying every day. Police raids, drugs, even poison, and just for being right on. The brothers are dead, and the marches still continue, and the banners still wave, the media still lies. The brothers are dead, and the 4th of July is still a national holiday. The brothers are dead, and when night comes, roll up the banners, hide them in the closet, and save them for the next parade. So there's my irony. It's my ironic moment. Any questions, guys? Can any of you guys want to ask some questions about anything you want to say?
Yeah, feel free to jump in. Or
no questions, any answers?
I mean, how does this, maybe, you know, we'd like to hear more about how this fits into the conversations you've been having, maybe, okay, about some of these issues, right?
I'll fall on the spot. I would say first that your experience is very different from anything any of our students have experienced, including me. We live in a very slow and probably privileged situation where, for example, when you, in other poems, talk about police, say, I'm friends with all the police. If I get pulled over, they say, oh, it's you, okay, well, just, you know, stop doing that. Just keep on going. We don't have to worry about often tickets or being arrested or whatever. In the last year, I've run stop signs. I've been speeding and don't have a seatbelt on, and they don't know my vehicle until I roll down the window. Oh, Michael, just don't do that again. No. So the privilege of our situation is pretty strong.
You live in Mayberry.
Yeah, that's probably a good way to put it. So,
can we assume it's a predominantly Caucasian community?
No, it's probably close to half and half.
It's a, you know, neighborhood, like people know.
Exactly.
I wonder how
it's a sure enough neighborhood.
Well, you know, let me. Okay.
But so when I'm thinking about my students listening to you, I'm thinking about them trying to just soak in how different your experience is from theirs.
And we treat it so laissez-faire, you know? It's like, okay, this happened, it's terrible, and blah, blah, moving right along.
Let me tell you, you know what you hit upon? We talk about racial profiling. Yeah. When I was a kid, we didn't know no racial, you know, there's a lot of terms that I think they invented words just to make these terms, even though they're just regular words. I say, gee whiz, you know, racial profiling, wow. That's a contraction. But we had what I called, well, I didn't call it out loud, but I would characterize it as the summer of 15. Now the summer, let me tell you about the summer of 15, very interesting, because I didn't realize this, but now when you look back, that was racial profiling. The summer of 15 is when we, as dudes, turn 15. Now, I guess there's some imaginary watermark we crossed, in terms of height. And now the cops notice us. Mm. Last summer they just whizzed right by us like nothing. Now, hey you, what are you doing? What do you guys do? They get out of their car, they come, and they harass us. Mm-hmm. And we're doing the same damn thing we did last summer, which was sitting on the stoop. Mm-hmm. You know, eating our ices. You know, right? But now they notice us, and we must have reached the plateau somewhere of they're that height where we have to now make them know that we're the ones in charge. You see, so they make us aware of their presence. All this time, up to now, they've been friendly Joe Bolton, the neighborhood cop. You see? They've been that. All up until now. Now, we don't even know what the hell we did wrong, but we did something wrong, and they're all looking at us, and their cars drive by slowly now. Passes. That's what I was trying to... wanted to show you here, this kid that he has the recording. You get to hear how brusquely the cops talk to him. It says, when I live in California, the cops would have a conversation with you. These are like thugs coming out of a car cruising for a fucking bruising. They want, it's like a gang, you know, that comes out of a car ready to beat you up. They're not being investigative, they're being bullies.